As we kind of step into this morning's message, before I read this scripture, I want to give a little bit of thoughts, because we finished Jonah last week and we looked at several important themes: God's calling, God's mercy, how God uses people, how God wants our hearts to be changed. But there's one thing that comes out of that I want to point out to you, and I will refer back to this in the message. And that is the My Calling Sheet. I want to challenge you. There, you've heard of the 80-20 rule, right? That supposedly in any volunteer organization, 20% of the people do 80% of the work. And this isn't about recruiting workers as much as it is the fact that that's not God's intent. God says, I'm going to save you, and I'm going to save you so I can use you, so you can be part of something really awesome. Now, you'll notice on this sheet that it doesn't say, I will teach third graders, or I will play the piano, or it doesn't say that. I think the first step is often discerning God's calling in your heart. So over the next month or so, I'm hoping to harass. Everybody that's part of this church family, honestly, I don't care if you're in first grade. Which of these things kind of touches your heart? Now, you might look at this and go, well, facilities doesn't sound very spiritual, but isn't it? I mean, it all belongs to God, and it's a place where we gather to worship God, and it's a place where we invite people to be part of us, and it's a place where we prepare ourselves to be used by God. So that's no less spiritual than prayer. Now, some of you will look at this and say, well, I care about all 9 of these. Okay, I want to invite you to pray. And you can turn this in today if you want. You can put it in the offering baskets. You can give it to me. You can leave it on your pew, whatever. But I would encourage you, if you need to take this home and pray over it, and just ask yourself, which of these areas do I care about? And one thing I want to tell you, I've been talking to a couple of our members of our church who are at a stage in their life when they can't go shovel snow, because they're past those years of their life. And I think there's a subtle tendency we have to say, well, I guess all you can do is pray. Wouldn't it be great? I mean, I think that that's part of the way. Here's a different way to look at it. God brings certain people to a place in their life when he's like, I want you to focus on prayer. I want you to pray for people, and I don't want you distracted by doing stuff. Kind of a Mary and Martha thing, if you know that scripture. So prayer is not if I can't do anything else, I guess I can pray. That's not what prayer is. So anyway, that's a sheet that I want you to have. We're starting a new series of ministry today, a new sermon series that's entitled, That's Not Normal. And if there's anything that Christianity is not supposed to be, it's normal. I mean, if you read scripture from the very beginning of Genesis, it becomes very clear that once people have sinned, once the world is turned away from God, people that seek God are going against the grain. They're not living normal lives. They're that person. If you've watched the Chosen videos, I love the fish symbol. Have you seen that fish symbol where there's all these fish swimming one direction and there's just a few different colored fish that are going against the grain? That's what Christianity is supposed to be. It's not supposed to be normal. The book of Acts says that these are people who have turned the world upside down. Now, I don't know about you, but upside down is not normal for me. In fact, I'm bad at upside down. Okay? Some people can stand on their head in the water. When I try to like do a headstand in the water, I get confused. I don't know which way is up. Upside down is not normal. Just a couple notes I wrote down here about this. The world says we're supposed to look out for number one, take care of ourselves. That's normal. But Christianity says deny yourself, take up your cross and follow me. The world says judge a book by its cover. That's normal. Christianity says no, God looks at the heart. He's not concerned about what's on the outside. The world says stuff matters. It's valuable. Hold on to it. Christianity says stuff is temporary. We should build up treasures in heaven. The world says it's all about control. We follow a man who said, I'm going to give up control, lay down his power in order to serve us and to become a servant. The world says it's about what we can see and touch. Christianity says there's a deeper spiritual reality. The world says, even other religions say normal is earn your way. Try to be good enough. You know, hopefully you can do enough stuff and build up enough points to get to heaven or wherever they believe you're going to go. That's normal in religion. Christianity says God in Jesus bridges the gap. We don't have to earn it. So we're not normal by the world standards. We're not normal by religious standards. I would even say that biblical Christianity is not normal by church standards. Much of Christianity, I think if we're honest, is a safe, boring religious obligation carefully designed to keep people comfortable so they can feel good about the fact that they're going to die and they have hope beyond the death. Now that's a good thing. Hope of life after death, that confidence is huge. A safe, boring religious obligation designed to keep people comfortable. It almost makes God a cosmic Santa Claus, doesn't it? Hope, he's making a list, checking it twice. I want to just do enough stuff. And his greatest goal, we think, is to give us an easy, healthy, and prosperous life. That's kind of normal Christianity. But you know what? As we study the book of Acts, chapters 12 through the end of the book, I look at what Jesus intended for his church. And I look at that safe, boring religious obligation, and it's not worth giving my life for. I want to ask you that question before I read the scripture this morning. Do you want to give your life for that kind of a thing? Maybe the better question is this. Is that what Jesus gave his life for? A group of people? Did Jesus die on the cross? Was he whipped until he was basically almost dead? And then drugged through the streets and humiliated and mocked and laughed at and spit upon. And he had a thorn of crowns placed on his head and he was nailed to a cross. Do you hear that? He was nailed to a cross. Was that to create a community of people who, you know, don't get drunk and we try to be nice to each other and we come to church once a week and sing a few songs? Check. biblical Christianity is not normal, and it's not safe. I mean, it's dangerous. Centuries of martyrs and other people who have let go of everything. I said Christianity, sometimes the way we portray it is boring. I tell you, this is excitement. This is changing the world. This is supernatural stuff. I mean, in today's scripture, Peter is in prison and, you know, all of a sudden an angel comes and the chains fall off. Now, if I was expecting to be executed the next day, chains falling off, that's pretty exciting. And then they walk out of the prison and the prison doors just open for them. I mean, that's kind of cool when you're leaving, you know, the grocery store and you've got groceries and the door opens automatically. You're like, yay, this is a prison. And the door opens. It's not boring and it's also not comfortable. Because Christianity ends up at a cross. And as somebody said once, there are no comfort zones on a cross. There's not a nice neighborhood. Instead of being about us, it's about God, His glory, His power, His will, His kingdom. I want to read to you from Acts chapter 12. And we're actually not going to finish the chapter. We're only going to go through verse 24. Verse 25 we'll deal with next week. Now, listen to this as if you haven't heard it before. Julie and I attended a church for a while where there was a woman who had been a professional actress. And she had actually played Nala in The Lion King on Broadway. And Mary could read a scripture in such a way that you're like, that's not important to even preach now because God's word has just come through. But hear this. It was about this time that King Herod arrested some who belonged to the church, intending to persecute them. He had James, the brother of John, put to death with the sword. When he saw that this met with approval among the Jews, he proceeded to seize Peter also. This happened during the festival of unleavened bread. After arresting him, he put him in prison, handing him over to be guarded by four squads of four soldiers each. Herod intended to bring him out for public trial after the Passover. So Peter was kept in prison, but the church was earnestly praying to God for him. The night before Herod was to bring him to trial, Peter was sleeping between two soldiers, bound with two chains, and sentries stood guard at the entrance. Suddenly, an angel of the Lord appeared, and a light shone in the cell. He struck Peter on the side, just stop. It's kind of a funny picture, isn't it? Almost like, hey, wake up. He struck Peter on the side and woke him up. Quick, get up, he said, and the chains fell off Peter's wrist. Then the angel said to him, put on your clothes and sandals. And Peter did so. Wrap your cloak around you and follow me, the angel told him. Peter followed him out of the prison, but he had no idea that what the angel was doing was really happening. He thought he was seeing a vision. Another possible translation there is he basically thought he was dreaming. They passed the first and second guards and came to the iron gate leading to the city. It opened for them by itself, and they went through it. When they had walked the length of one street, suddenly the angel left him. Then Peter came to himself and said, now I know without a doubt that the Lord has sent his angel and rescued me from Herod's clutches and from everything the Jewish people were hoping would happen. When this had dawned on him, he went to the house of Mary, the mother of John, also called Mark, where many people had gathered and were praying. Peter knocked at the outer entrance, and a servant named Rhoda came to answer the door. When she recognized Peter's voice, she was so overjoyed, she ran back without opening it and exclaimed, "Peter is at the door." "You're out of your mind," they told her. When she kept insisting that it was so, they said, "It must be his angel." But Peter kept on knocking. And when they opened the door and saw him, they were astonished. Peter motioned with his hand for them to be quiet and described how the Lord had brought him out of prison. "Tell James and the other brothers and sisters about this," he said. And then he left for another place. In the morning, there was no small commotion among the soldiers as to what had become of Peter. After Herod had a thorough search made for him and did not find him, he cross-examined the guards and ordered that they be executed. Let's stop right there. We'll touch on the last couple of verses at the end. Let's pray. Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be pleasing in your sight. For you are our rock and our redeemer. Speak to us from your word. In Jesus' name, amen. So, up to this point, the church has been growing crazy. I mean, there's some persecution going on, but the apostles have basically not been touched. For some reason, maybe because of influence and some pressure from some people, the persecution had really not touched the apostles themselves. But Herod, and this is actually the Herod who, when Jesus was born, had the children killed. That was this guy's grandfather. So this is grandson Herod, and he arrested some who belonged to the church, and he really wanted to get on the right side of the Jewish people, and so he had James, the brother of John, put to death with the sword. We have to understand that was traumatic for the church, because up to this point, even though there had been persecution, there was kind of this sense that, hey, these guys, these leaders of ours, they're going to be okay. We'll always have somebody to look for, to look to. And now James, the brother of John, part of Jesus' inner circle, is put to death with the sword. Now, one of the questions we want to touch on this morning is, you know, James and John, brothers, right there with Jesus. John lived another 50 years and died actually a natural death. And James is dead. Why? Was John more righteous? No, we don't have any indication of that. Had James done something that made God mad? Had God fallen asleep? In fact, there are people that say, oh, well, the reason for this is because, you know, there's no indication that the people were praying for James and they prayed for Peter, so Peter was rescued. Oh, that must mean that they hadn't prayed for James. That doesn't make sense. Everything we know about the early church said they were praying. They were praying. And it says later that they were earnestly praying for Peter. There are times in life and in death when it doesn't make sense, does it? Why did John live and James die? Why did Peter get miraculously rescued and James had just died? In Ecclesiastes 7, verse 15, the author talks about this and he says, you know, I've seen in chapter 7 and 8, he says, I've seen people who live righteous lives suffer. And I've seen people who live awful lives be blessed. And if you're taking notes here, I want you to know one of the first things we see here is sometimes terrible things happen. And we like to wrestle with the question of, well, so did God cause this or did God allow this? It's pretty clear in this passage that that's not the important question. The important question in this passage is, well, it's not even a question, it's a statement. It's saying, you know what? Sometimes things happen. Some people live, some people die. I love in Daniel chapter 3, when Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego are brought before the king, and they are threatened with being thrown into the fiery furnace, and they say, you know, king, we will not bow, and our God can rescue us. You know what they say next? But even if he does not, we're not going to bow. There's this idea that recurs throughout Scripture that says, sometimes we're not going to know the whys. Sometimes we're not going to know why good things happen, why bad things happen. But the reality is sometimes terrible things happen. And as Christians, I think we, of all people, need to say, number one, we're okay with that because we have hope beyond this. Number two, we need to say that to other people, because if we begin to believe and to tell people that it's all going to be fine, well, what happens when it's not? So Herod has arrested James, had him executed. And then he says, oh, that seemed to go well. I think I'll grab somebody else. He grabs Peter, puts him in prison, has him guarded by four squads of four soldiers. Normally, you'd have one squad, maybe, guarding an important prisoner. He says four squads. He has him chained to two guards. Normally, there would be one guard who is chained to him. And there are 16 guys at the door. Luke clearly wants us to know that this is hopeless, humanly speaking. As Dr. Luke writes this, he's like, I want to make sure you guys understand, this was not just, oh, the guards, one guy fell asleep and Peter snuck out. No, he's saying very clearly, this is bad stuff. Side note, I think one of the things that we need to be reminded of on this is that's where we are without Jesus. We're not just kind of captured. We are chained. Scripture says we are dead. Verse 5, so Peter was kept in prison, but the church was earnestly praying for him. And this is a terrifying situation, but that earnestly is a powerful word. They're praying hard. They're saying, God, help our guy. We already lost James. We don't want to lose Peter. I mean, it's getting scary. One of the people that I think was probably praying pretty hard was John, because he's like, okay, this guy's my brother. Plus, he's figured out, you know, Jesus' inner circle was Peter, James, and John. If James is already dead and Peter goes, you know, John's going, I'm a little nervous now. I'm probably next. And so it's important for us to know that there was prayer going on. And prayer is powerful. We'll talk more about that in a few weeks. The night before Herod was to bring him to trial. Basically, in that society, what that means is Peter's in jail knowing tomorrow, trial, dead. This is the night before his last long walk, dead man walking kind of thing. But he's sleeping. I don't want to read too much into that, but it tells you something about Peter's heart. And his faith, I'm not sure I would be sleeping in that situation. So in your notes, I want you to know that God's sovereignty is not stopped by impossible situations. You see that? It's an impossible situation. But God says, not even a problem. Just like God looked at each of us, if you're a follower of Jesus, and said, wow, you've got a lot of sin in your life, I can handle that. It's an impossible situation, but God's sovereignty is not stopped by that. Suddenly an angel of the Lord appears and a light shone in the cell. He struck Peter on the side. Hey, wake up, wake up. And the chains fell off Peter's wrists. Imagine this from Peter's perspective. I mean, how many of you wake up bright-eyed and bushy-tailed when you wake up? How many of you? Okay. I don't like any of you anymore, but it's okay. How many of you are like me where you wake up and you're like, what? Where? What? Peter was still probably foggy and half asleep. He thinks he's dreaming. He doesn't know what's going on. He doesn't say, oh, angel, I figured you were coming. The angel said to him, put on your clothes and sandals. And Peter did so. Wrap your cloak around you and follow me. When God is working, I think it's important for us to sometimes not ask too many questions. When God says, do this, sometimes we're like, okay, I'm going to do that, God, but I want to know kind of how do you want me to do and what do you want me to do and how do you want me to dress? And God says, Peter did so. Followed him out of the prison. He had no idea that the angel was doing this was really happening. He thought he was seeing a vision. He basically thought God was giving him a dream. Come to the iron gate leading to the city, and it opened for them by itself. They walked the length of one street, and the angel left him. Then Peter kind of wakes up and says, oh, now I get it. God has sent his angel and rescued me. And even though Herod's clutches and the Jewish people were hoping to do stuff to him, his focus is on the fact that God did it. He doesn't say anything that indicates that he thinks, wow, I'm worth saving. He says, God has sent his angel and rescued me. And then again in verse 17, when he describes it, he describes how the Lord had brought him out of prison. He's saying, it's about God, it's about God, it's about God. Now that matters. We'll come back to that at the end of the message. He goes to the door, and I love this. It's like kind of a classic sitcom scene, right? It's like, or maybe it's from The Wizard of Oz when they arrive at the Emerald City and they're knocking on the door. Knocking on the door, and they're knocking on the door. Then Rhoda comes to the door, and she's so excited, she doesn't open the door. She goes, Peter's at the door, Peter's at the door. And they all think she's out of her mind. She kept saying, no, it's Peter, it's Peter. And probably somebody is saying, well, where is he? She's like, oh. Here's the third thing I want you to notice here. When God is working, it's often, from a human perspective at least, unbelievable. God does stuff, turns people around that you don't think could ever be saved. Dan Evans told me a few stories that he couldn't share last week about lives of prisoners and the things they have been through and the things that have been done to them and the things that they had done. And there was story after story after story after story of people that you're like, well, surely that person could not be leading worship for a bunch of prisoners. When God is working, it's often unbelievable, not just to non-Christians, but even to Christians. One of the things that happens, and this is so sad to me, is sometimes we hear about things that are going on and we're like, yeah, really? I don't know. That sounds pretty crazy to me. But I tell you, trying to think of what story to tell on this. A few years ago, I was in China, and we were doing a training for a group of pastors, and we were kind of out in on the edge of a city, and we realized we didn't have anything to write on. Like, you know, we needed to do some teaching, and we as Americans nowadays, we don't know what to do. Well, first of all, we don't know what to do without a computer and a video projector. But in that case, we didn't know what to do without a whiteboard. And we didn't have a whiteboard. We had markers, but probably didn't want to write on the wall. And so we were, you know, the Americans were like, oh, we should, we've got some money. Let's find a store where we can go and buy a whiteboard by tomorrow morning. That's what the Americans thought. Here's what the Chinese pastors thought. They said, well, before we do that, maybe we should just pray that God would provide us a whiteboard, because that's what we need. And honestly, I think my brain was saying this. Yeah, we'll pray, but then we'll go buy a whiteboard. And we prayed, and before we left, somebody from one of those pastors' churches knocked on the door because they had, guess what? A whiteboard. And, I mean, yeah, you can explain that away as just normal stuff. But how many times has anybody ever knocked at your door on, late Sunday night at about 11 o'clock p.m. saying, hey, I got a whiteboard. Would you like it? When God works, it's unbelievable. And there are huge, much more huge things than that. But God is working, and some of the believers are sitting back there going, oh, no. So Peter keeps knocking. Side note, when God is working and you believe that God is working but the door's not opening, keep knocking. Peter tells them what's going on, what has happened, and described how the Lord brought him up. He gave glory clearly to the Lord. In the morning, there was no small commotion, understatement of the year, among the soldiers as to what had become of Peter. Most scholars think that the way this is written, basically the guards woke up and said, What? Where'd he go? Herod made a thorough search for him and did not find him. He cross-examined the guards and ordered that they be executed. Again, when God works, it's often unbelievable. How do we explain this? And how do we explain James dies, Peter's rescued? I think part of the key to understanding this in view of God's sovereignty is we need to remember that we have to understand that we don't understand. We have to understand that we don't understand. Scripture says we see through a glass darkly. This world is not our home. God's sovereignty means that he's in control, and it means that he uses things. God's answer to James was no. God's answer to Peter was yes. Our job is to ask. God's job is to answer. Let me say that again. Our job is to ask. God's job is to answer. And it all kind of comes clear if you look at the last few verses. Herod has traveled to Caesarea, and he's been quarreling with these people. And they have this big thing for him. And Herod, wearing his royal robes, sat on his throne and delivered a public address. They shouted, "This is the voice of a God, not of a man." Immediately, because Herod did not give praise to God, an angel of the Lord struck him down, and he was eaten by worms and died. Gross, huh? But the word of God continued to spread and flourish. You know what this is about? It's about trusting God's sovereignty and giving him the glory. I pray that God is going to do something great in and through this church. And one of my fears is that if that happens, we'll ask ourselves, oh, who was crucial in that? Oh, you know, what'll happen is, oh, God really used Gems and Cadets. We should give a lot of credit to Dan and Holly. Well, I mean, if God uses it, we should say, good for you. Thanks for being faithful. God did it. Because Herod did not give praise to God, he was struck down. So, real quick, here's the so what. The key to understanding God's sovereignty is, number one, God is God, I'm not. Enough said. Number two, God sees the whole tapestry, the big picture. We don't. Number three, we need to trust him. God will use everything. I mean, honestly, how many of you at some point in your life have been encouraged by Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, their story? Yeah? How many of you have been encouraged by and your life has been changed for the better by somebody who went through a tragedy? Yeah. God uses that stuff. And we say with Job, though he slay me, yet I will praise him. Last two, God is good. God is good, even when I don't understand. And finally this, God's goodness is best seen at the cross. You want to know whether God is good? Let's remember what we're celebrating as we transition to communion now. Let's remember the fact that we are here and able to worship him because of what Jesus did on the cross. When we question whether God is good, it's a natural question. But the answer is, God is good. Well, he formed us. He shaped us. He called us. He loved us. He sent his son to die on a cross for us. That's good. But it's not normal, is it? I mean, if you've ever worked in a supervisory position, in a job, you might have really cared about your employees. You know, your direct reports, they were important to you. Would you have resigned your position to die for them? That's what Jesus, who, though he was in the form of God, was seated at the right hand of the Father. He was on the royal throne, left heaven out of love. Is God good? Maybe we need to learn the call and response thing. that they do in some churches, you know. You guys know this. God is good all the time. God is good all the time. And we know that because we see it encapsulated in the elements before us today. We're going to transition now to communion.